Hanover Square Press and Harper Audio present Made Men, The Story of Goodfellas, by Glenn Kenny, performed by Stephen Graybill. A note before we begin. For a recipe for ziti with meat sauce, a Goodfellas timeline, notes, and more, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider. Or go directly to harperaudio.hc.com/made men. Treachery is beautiful if it makes us sing. Jean Genet, The Thief's Journal. Prologue. Martin Scorsese, December 1989. I ran into Paul Schrader in the hall the other day. He's finishing his movie. I said to him, "It figures I see you here. We're the only two guys who are going to work through Christmas. Everyone else is clearing out." Martin Scorsese was referring to the man who wrote the screenplay for his galvanizing 1976 movie Taxi Driver, with whom he'd subsequently worked on Raging Bull and The Last Temptation of Christ. Schrader himself started directing features in 1978, forging an idiosyncratic path with films that often mixed searching spirituality with sexuality and violence. But he never shook, or tried to shake, the association with Scorsese. The Raging Bull experience, which saw De Niro and Scorsese rewriting Schrader's script almost from scratch, had bruised Schrader's feelings somewhat. But the two men retained an affinity with and an affection for each other. More to the point, 15 years after they first worked together, they were still as consumed by filmmaking as they had been then. Schrader was finishing his disturbing Venice set, The Comfort of Strangers, written by Harold Pinter from a novel by Ian McEwan. Scorsese was caught up in assembling a picture called Goodfellas. At this time, and for some time after its release, it was, as you'll see, rendered in print as Goodfellas, with a capital F. This changed over the years. No one to this day, to my knowledge, can pinpoint when it changed or why. Both pictures would see release in the fall of 1990. Scorsese mentioned this run-in to me before we ourselves got to work. He had set aside a couple of hours so we could start on an essay to which he would attach his byline. In 1989, I was working at a magazine called Video Review, which would be celebrating its 10th year of publication in 1990. That it had survived for 10 years as a consumer magazine was a testimony to a lot of things, and mainly to the fact that home video and home theater in the late 80s was a sufficiently hot topic to sustain a regular readership of a few hundred thousand. For the 10th anniversary issue, we were soliciting the opinions of various ostensible luminaries and visionaries on how home video had affected life and culture, and what effect it would have in the future. I should emphasize again that this was 1989. Home video meant VHS, and maybe a little bit of laser disc, the DVD, video streaming, oversized flat-screen TVs, critically acclaimed original programming on cable, the whole "is TV better than movies" debate. All of this was in the future. What seemed to me, and to everybody else, the distant future. Most of the predictions we would run were in the form of sound bites solicited in phone interviews. J.G. Ballard: "I look forward to the day when specialty video producers, the equivalent of Sun Records and the like in the music business 20, 30 years ago, and the equivalent of small publishers in the book trade, really can begin to reach out to the public." Paula Abdul: "The big movie musical will return to prominence in this decade as recording artists take the video music concept one step further." But for the keynote address, so to speak, I thought Martin Scorsese would be ideal. The filmmaker was also a well-known film lover, passionately concerned with film preservation, and a great proponent of home video as a medium, however initially imperfect, for movie appreciation. So I got the number for his office and called. I was greeted by Julia Judge, his assistant at the time. I laid out what we wanted to do, and I also stipulated that if Scorsese had neither the time nor inclination to sit down and write such a piece himself, I would be delighted to come up to the office, interview him, and construct a as-told-to piece. Either way, I said, we would pay Scorsese $3,000 for a 1,000-word article.
$3,000?
Judge responded, sounding impressed. I wasn't aware of it at the time, but the director was still trying to bounce back from personal financial crisis dating from earlier in the decade. His cinematic output continued, but the fieriness that distinguished his prior pictures frequently took a different and sometimes less volatile form. His critical profile seemed to have diminished ever so slightly during this time as well. In 1985's After Hours, he experimented with a form of proto-indie guerrilla filmmaking. In 1986, The Color of Money was a sequel to The Hustler and starred Paul Newman and a very up-and-coming Tom Cruise. A solid film with solid returns. He worked for his old friend Steven Spielberg, directing an episode of the latter's attempt to revive the Twilight Zone television series. He was sought out by megastar and future king of pop Michael Jackson to make a music video. He contributed to the anthology film New York Stories with fellow graying eminences Francis Coppola and Woody Allen. Scorsese was the youngest of the three. And he was also able to achieve, finally, his passion project for many years, an adaptation of Nicolas Kazantzakis's novel The Last Temptation of Christ, which attracted the wrong kind of controversy at the wrong time. Controversy of the sort, one would think, to make Scorsese look like a troublemaker in the eyes of the studio heads. To make matters worse, the controversy did not translate into box office success by any metric. I can't say that Scorsese was feeling as if he was standing on shaky ground when I came along with the video review offer. But I'll always remember being struck by the enthusiasm with which my offer was accepted. Another well-known writer I was pursuing for the project was demanding $5 a word and a free video camcorder, neither of which Video Review was willing, finally, to cough up for him. Judge soon got back to me taking up the offer and stipulating that Scorsese would indeed be too busy to sit down and write it himself. Often when the director has a magazine article or op-ed piece with his byline attached, he's done it with the assist of a writer. For many years, the critic and director Kent Jones, who also worked for a period as Scorsese's video archivist, filled that role. We set a date for the third week of December. Scorsese's office at the time was in the Brill Building, the legendary then-entertainment industry cynosure on the outer edge of Manhattan's Times Square. Its reputation was built around the fact that it once held the offices of song publishers, many of whose staff and freelance songwriters in the 50s and 60s would become superstars after doing time there, Carole King, Neil Diamond, etc. The structure also housed offices for television and film producers, and various technical facilities as well. Scorsese's editing suites for Goodfellas were in the same building, which made the place ultra-convenient for the filmmaker. His office was not much to look at. It was a big open space with linoleum floors and pale green walls and a couple of square pillars. Judge sat at a desk in more or less the middle of the room. Scorsese himself had a small office built into the corner of the room, and after I was introduced to him, that's where we settled. I had a tape recorder and a legal pad. We didn't spend too much time on small talk, merely observing the coming of the holiday and the fact that we were all still working, before getting down to business. The man immediately struck me as, yes, intense, but also warm, friendly, considerate. I asked him a question. When did you first hear about home video? and off we went. He stood as he spoke, paced around a bit, and every now and then, after he had gone off on a long tangent, he would take a hit off an inhaler of asthma medication. Eventually, we talked about the work in progress. There was a sense, almost palpable, of his delight that he was trying something really new, and also a slight sense of trepidation, as in, what are they going to make of this? And of course, the post-production work on this new film was consuming. Getting back to the subject of our essay, he revealed, not surprisingly, an enthusiasm for home video because of its ability to let the user create a library of films and cross-reference it at his or her convenience. He told a charming story about watching the original Universal The Mummy, directed by Carl Freund, with one of his daughters, and then leapfrogging to James Whale's The Bride of Frankenstein. He discussed issues that would continue to be hot buttons even into the age of DVDs and Blu-rays. For example, how ultra-wide movies should be presented on home screens. He also bemoaned, as filmmakers did and do, what he called the shorter attention span encouraged by television and video. But he recognized that everything is, or can be, relative. You realize sometimes as you're making a film that today's audience may not sit for a shot of a certain length. This may not change the way I'll make a picture. Whatever the pace, if it's right for the shot or scene, that's the way it's got to be. As in The Last Temptation of Christ, where a number of sequences take on the tone and mood of the desert. When I was in Morocco, I got a real sense of timelessness, of everything moving at 120 frames per second. Extreme slow motion, almost like a trance. That's part of the effect that I wanted from the movie, and it's part of the reason the movie is 2 hours and 46 minutes long. I decided that certain elements of temptation would be fast, fine. But in the desert, there's a sense of mysticism you experience that often comes in a trance-like manner. This led him, again, to the movie he was currently editing. As for my new film, Goodfellas, even if it's 2.5 hours long, I'm hopeful it will be one of the fastest-paced pictures ever made because it tells a story in a style heavily influenced by documentary TV reporting and these new tabloid shows. After we were finished with the formal part of the interview, Scorsese continued to enthuse about the movie. "In a way, it's the most like television I've ever done," he said, sounding a little surprised with himself. Not just The Untouchables, the late 50s, early 60s TV series, not Brian's film, he clarified, referring to the 1987 movie directed by his old friend Brian De Palma and featuring Robert De Niro in the role of Al Capone. "In terms of the narration, I love that staccato rat-a-tat thing you get sometimes with Walter Winchell on the old series. And that continues, I think, into today's true crime and exposé television shows, a kind of tabloid approach. That's definitely part of what's informing the style of this movie." At the end of our session, I handed the director my then new hardcover copy of the book, Scorsese on Scorsese, which he signed. "To Glenn Kenny, thanks and appreciation, Martin Scorsese, 1989. Despite his familiarity with the movie's milieu, the scenario of Goodfellas did not have entirely the same kind of personal pull that such stories as Raging Bull, New York, New York, and yes, even Taxi Driver had at the time for the filmmaker. There's no real Scorsese surrogate in Goodfellas, but there's a near anthropological interest in the manners and rituals of the modern gangster's world. Practically voyeuristic, you could say. And that perspective is shot through with a good deal of memory play material, derived from Scorsese's childhood and teen years. Two movies subsequent to Goodfellas, 1995's Casino and 2013's The Wolf of Wall Street, cast a similar eye on the actual crimes that gangsters commit and how they commit them. To the extent that Wolf's immersive depiction of the depraved Dionysian modes of its characters' existences proved off-putting to some critics. Despite the squalor and tension and ultimate betrayals depicted in Goodfellas, there were similar worries at the time of its release that Scorsese did not emphasize sufficiently just how thoroughly corrupt his protagonists were. One reason the movie took so long to edit was because of the nuances of perspective that Scorsese and his longtime editor, Thelma Schoonmaker, tucked into the film's overall structure. For all the excitement that Scorsese expressed about what he was doing, he was a little uncertain, sheepish, even. He again mentioned that he wasn't sure how the picture would be received. He certainly didn't give the impression of knowing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.